I've stepped away from the studio and I'm about to get face to face with the man behind something that's going to start this thing off with a punch. We're talking about one championship. We're talking about a spectacular global sporting franchise and something the likes of which Asia has never seen before. You're about to meet the man behind it all. But first of all, let's take a little look at what he has produced for this region. Amazing stuff. And here we go then, in depth with the man behind all of that, the founder, chairman, and CEO of One Championship, Mr. Chatri Sityodtong. Chatri, it's fantastic to have you with us here at SportsPro Asia. You know, I've worked in TV a long time, but those sizzle reels, they just get me, and your one gets me every single time. You've done this so often. Do you still get a thrill, a chill, when you see something like that? Chatri, are you catching me? Just need to check in that
yes,
we've got this one.
Sorry. I don't know what happened. Thank you so much for having me. Appreciate it and look forward to our discussion.
Yeah, I was just saying, watching that reel, just watching that sheer entertainment, drama, passion, does it still get you? You do this a lot. You know, you stand in front of people, you explain your vision, you talk about this amazing property of yours. But when you see something like that, does it still really send a shiver down your spine?
Yeah, definitely. You know, this is my greatest passion in life. And so I've been doing martial arts for 35 years. I still train every day. And I just wanted to present the authenticity of martial arts. You know, Asia has been the home of martial arts for 5,000 years. One Championship is now the world's largest martial arts organization, the largest global stage of martial arts, featuring, you know, Muay Thai, kickboxing, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, submission grappling, and mixed martial arts and other martial arts. So for sure, it gets me fired up every time because this is my greatest passion in life. And the most important thing for me is to present Asia's greatest cultural treasure in a way that is truly authentic to the region by celebrating values of integrity, humility, honor, respect, courage, discipline, compassion. But by telling the stories of our heroes to inspire nations and to unite 4 billion people on the continent to celebrate what I always say, values, heroes, and stories. Of course, we do it in a millennial format, and that's why the millennials love us. The lights, the laser, the firework, the show, the actual entertainment value. That's very important. So, have been very fortunate to have what I would argue the greatest roster of martial arts world champions on the planet. Out of 550 athletes, we have 150 world champions across various martial arts. That is the most number of world champions by far of any organization in the world. Getting to live the life of my dreams, getting to share my greatest passion with the world, getting to celebrate Asia's greatest cultural treasure with the world is, for me, it always gets me every time.
There's a lot for us to pick apart there. But, this is billed as new horizons, of course. And over the next couple of days, so much is going to happen at SportsPro Asia. But specific to what we're talking about here, we can't ignore the so-called new normal. Because there you are. Here I am. We're sitting on one of these virtual conferences that we've grown so used to right now. But the reality is that you, in terms of what you do, are back. Right here in Singapore, which is where both of us are. We've seen successive Friday nights of one championship action at the Sports Hub at the indoor stadium. And we've got a massive event. You have Inside the Matrix coming up with some fantastic, fantastic fights at the end of this month. How good does it feel to be back, albeit in the new normal?
Obviously, it feels phenomenal. We came back in June in China, and then July, August, September in Thailand. But Singapore, one champ, we've been working very closely with the Singapore government for the last few months, and been very blessed that Singapore government has entrusted one championship to be the first global property in sports, music, or entertainment in Singapore to come back online with an international event. And I'm super grateful to the Singapore government for leading Asia with one championship as the very first international world-class production of any kind across the continent. So it's a huge statement by the Singapore government. It's a huge statement of one championship. But definitely when we were down, call it March, April, May, those 3 months were very, very tough, very, very difficult months. But, I've been blessed with an incredible team. And I always say the key to dealing with any crisis is both creativity and resilience. Creativity, because in any crisis, you're always faced with new problems, new challenges you've never seen before. And so I strongly encourage my team to think of out of the box, to think of new ways to solve problems. And then resilience, because in a crisis, you're gonna get more no's than ever before, more failures than ever before, and having the grit and the resilience to overcome that. And so far, I can tell you my team has passed with flying colors. I'm so blessed to serve such an incredible team.
The amazing thing about this as well, Chatri, is that before everything, and we all ground to a halt, we all stopped traveling. Things just stopped happening in so many industries. Before that, the one championship to me, as someone who's worked on sport around Asia for all of my professional life, was just a juggernaut. Every time I looked, you were on. You were on in Manila 1 week, Singapore the next, Yangon the next, world-class fights, world title fights, this incredible roller coaster you were on that was just running and running and running. Suddenly to go from that to having to exist as we do now via, who knows, social media engagement, storytelling, whatever you can do. How much of a pivot, as we nowadays say so often, was that? How on earth could you adapt and adjust to such a difficult situation?
So we were lucky in the sense that we were already expanding our content stack. And what I mean by that is, a couple years ago, we launched One Esports because we found out that, a very large chunk of our fans, up to 45% of our fans, were actually gamers as well. And there are 1.3 billion gamers in Asia. So we launched One Esports, and we were able to do online tournaments while One Championship Martial Arts wasn't allowed to throw events, right, during those 3 months. and we actually achieve record viewership numbers, record high metrics during the whole lockdown in Singapore. And then, of course, we have The Apprentice coming up. We go into production next week. And that's going to be our first foray into the general entertainment content stack. And it's very much like, Disney. You know, Disney, if you look at the history of Disney, Disney started off with Mickey Mouse and eventually went to Marvel Avengers or ABC and ESPN and whatnot and became a full stack media property. And obviously, I would call it the world's greatest media property. And One Champion has a very similar path and very similar approach. We start off, of course, our crown jewels is our sports property, our martial arts property, but there's so many content stacks that we see, in terms of what the mainstream audience wants across Asia and around the world.
I'm really interested in that. And I think I want to just park that one just for a moment and come back to all of those different layers of the diversification and the ambition that you guys are showing there. But I want to come back just initially to the circumstances we find ourselves in, because, you know, anyone who has seen you in action, anyone who listens to you knows that you espouse these core values, that you talk about Asian values, you talk about the rigors and the traditions, the disciplines of martial arts. And I can't escape this sense that you have been able to, in a real world crisis, apply some of this. And okay, we see how things are happening in Asia in the response to COVID-19. And we also see a very different story in the West. I just wonder if there's a parallel there in the way that here we've been able to cope relatively well. Is that something that you see as a tie-in with the values that One Championship espouses, and maybe right down to some of the things you've been preaching in terms of, you know, heroes and engagement and tapping into certain Asian mindsets?
Yeah, I mean, most definitely. No, for me, I always say that there's a true deeper meaning of martial arts than what the West presents. The West presents a blood sport of violence, you know, trash talking, hatred, and stuff like that. But the real meaning of martial arts here, in the birthplace of martial arts, is that through thousands of hours of training, you inherit, you know, these incredible values of integrity, humility, honor, respect, courage, discipline, and compassion. But also you inherit, you know, a warrior spirit to conquer adversity in life. And that's very much been my life. Right? I mean, I was fortunate enough to escape poverty with the Asian financial crisis when my father abandoned the family and we were left, on one meal a day. And then in this crisis here, this is something that I tell my team and I say, look, you know, any leadership team can do well when the global economy is doing well. I told them that only extraordinary leadership teams are able to deliver phenomenal performance in the middle of a crisis. And again, this is the worst crisis in 100 years, right? I mean, most industries are down and potentially out, and many, many companies have gone bankrupt. Many more will go bankrupt. Companies who have massive debt burdens next year, I think the crisis economically is just going to get worse. It's not going to get better because we're not going to get a V-shaped recovery in many of the brick and mortar industries. And so I go back again to creativity and resilience, but I would agree. I mean, definitely, the values that One Champion exemplifies, the values that I exemplify through my martial arts training is definitely something that helped One Championship thrive in this crisis. And it wasn't that way, you know, in the first month it was very difficult. When the first few days happened, I definitely was disappointed and stressed and frustrated and just sad. But once I go over the first few days, then, you know, this is back in early March, I said to our team, let's go. This is the go time. And that's the truth. The reality is for us as individuals, as companies, or as countries, right? Moments of crisis dictate our trajectory in life, full stop. Individuals, companies, or countries.
Yeah, that's a really good point you make. I don't know, you having said that, whether you want to dwell on this, but I want to get a sense of, let's go back to mid 2019, and I want to get a sense of exactly how big one championship is. You know, I'm seeing Joe Rogan on his podcast and his guests just raving about the quality of what you guys do, the innovations, the quality, the sheer spectacle that you guys are producing. You know, you've been described as a monster, Dana White obviously calling you that. And there's this recognition. And now there must be a sense of frustration. You know, I just wonder how big you were, how big you still are, and what has changed.
So actually what's crazy, as I said, in this whole, the last few months, we've hit record high after record high in terms of our viewership numbers, our digital metrics, our social metrics, our TV viewership numbers. And so I think everyone staying at home has actually been good for One Champion. So whether it's our martial arts business or esports business, we're hitting record highs literally every week. And I get this full report, you know, it's a gajillion statistics. Every country, we're on fire and in our core markets. Obviously, some countries, we're still relatively new, like in the US, et cetera. But in our more kind of core markets here in Asia, things are just been on fire in terms of viewership metrics. And for me, that's the most important thing, right? The health metrics. And so last year, we averaged 29 million viewers per event. And the stats obviously tabulated by Nielsen and all the other data sources. And that puts us way, way above our Western counterparts, you know, and it's a deliberate strategy. We purposely go on all the free to air channels, the biggest broadcasters across Asia. We went on the biggest digital platforms. In the initial years, we gave all of our content for free. And so, you know, our metrics literally just skyrocketed. And it's a difference in approach, right? Strategically, when you look at our US counterparts, they're behind a double paywall. So you're going to have smaller viewership numbers. You are. It's just, you know, if you're behind a double paywall. So it's a strategy, a choice. You know, our strategy is much like Facebook in the early days, you know, when Facebook in the first several years, or even WhatsApp or YouTube, where they gave away everything for free to consumers and consumers just wrote it and eventually you monetize. And we're now in that place of monetization and it's accelerating as we see it. And so again, this whole crisis, again, it brings out the worst and best in people, right? We saw that, you know, as individuals, we saw looting and rioting and racism in some countries. We saw, you know, violence. But in other countries, we saw, you know, incredible acts of compassion and kindness by nurses and doctors and strangers. And it's no different for companies. You know, you've seen some companies stumble and you've seen some companies shine. And we just, again, like I said, it's not me, it's my team. I'm truly blessed to serve the greatest team in the world.
Now, you know, I'm really interested here in a couple of things about what you do with this engagement, for instance. Now, when you're unable to, okay, you're putting events on, okay, you're putting events on as broadcast events right now, you're unable to get backsides on seats, which is something that you were doing. But I'm interested here in that, let's say, for example, you took the States, if you were looking, as you said, in the wake of this praise, this buzz, this vibe that was happening in the States, you'd have been looking to get significant carriage, significant engagement over there. But presumably that would be just to watch your fighters in action. Instead, here in Asia, it looks as if there's a much deeper engagement. You're a great storyteller. You're building these wonderful personalities, these stories, these characters have overcome adversity to become world champions. So at a time like this, are you leaning more on that then? You're leaning on the content that you can produce based around these stories rather than event-based, you know, yeah. Revenue, obviously, primarily.
Yeah. Yes. I'm definitely, you know, that's a very insightful a question. You know, from day one, you know, our mission has been to unleash, literally written down on a PowerPoint, our mission is to unleash real life superheroes who ignite the world with hope, strength, dreams, and inspiration. Versus our competitors, our global competitors, is sell a fight. There is no mission behind it. There is no purpose, higher purpose than just to sell a fight and make money and espouse violence. And that's a very, very different approach. We are trying to, you know, our hashtag is we are one. We are trying to genuinely celebrate these incredible values that, you know, grandmothers and little children would celebrate. You know, we are telling the stories of these incredible heroes who literally inspire and unite entire countries. And of course, we want to tell these incredible, against all odds, stories to inspire any individual across the planet. You know, whether you're a doctor, whether you're a CEO, whether you're a street kid from Bogota or Manila, some of these incredible stories of orphans who became world champions on the global stage of one championship, just, you know, can make adults weep, but at the same time inspire children, adults, to live their greatest life, to dream more, do more, and be more in life. And that's ultimately why I started One Championship. You know, I really felt that the West was misportraying martial arts. And, you know, I am the only, out of the three major global organizations, I am the only lifelong martial artist who has practiced and trained and taught and fought for the last 35 years. And I want to bring that authenticity to the world.
I'm really interested in bringing this just into Asia. Now, obviously, Asia, given its absolute vast scale, means that you can scale accordingly, which is one of the reasons why you can become such a huge global property. But the other thing about Asia, and this is something that, you know, in my career, I've worked for a kind of colonial force in terms of Premier League football, where you've had this commonality in that, because a lot of these people around Asia, football fans, support, whether it's Manchester United, Milan, or whoever it may be, that kind of superficially pulls people together. But I've also worked in terms of Asia's football scene. And in that, one of the things that became very apparent is it's quite difficult to have a sort of unified pan-Asian football identity, in that, you know, you've got tremendous passion in a country like Indonesia, you've got tremendous passion in, say, Korea, but people in Korea might not be that interested in what's happening in Indonesia. However, what I've seen with One Championship, what I've seen with martial arts, is it does seem to harness a greater sort of, you know, unity, a commonality in terms of certain ideals of people in very, very different and very diverse Asian markets. Now, that must be something that you were aware of. Is it something that perhaps has even pleasantly surprised you as your story has progressed with One?
Yes, I mean, when I started One Championship, I have to admit that I was very naive. In many ways, I was blessed not to have come from the media industry. I literally said to myself, hey man, martial arts is the greatest cultural treasure in Asia. It's 5,000-year history. Millions of parents all over the continent send their kids to martial arts, not to learn violence, not to learn trash talking, not to learn all the despicable stuff, to learn these incredible values that I was talking about earlier, to learn to inherit a warrior spirit, to conquer adversity in life. This is why literally parents, millions of parents all over the continent send their children to martial arts schools. And that's the martial arts that I grew up on, and that's the martial arts I know. That's the one I want to showcase. But I mean, the truth is, I was very naive. You know, I had no idea how hard. I mean, guys, I'll tell you this, right? The first 3 years of One Championship was a complete disaster. Literally thousands of rejections, thousands of failures every single day. I met with over 100 institutional investors. They all rejected me. I met with broadcasters. They all rejected me. Brands all rejected me. Athletes rejected me. Employees didn't want to apply. They thought it was stupid. I mean, everyone from broadcasters to governments to agencies were telling me that, you know, Asians don't like sports. They don't need sports. We already have F1. We have NBA. We have Champions League. Why do we need an Asian league? But here's the thing. No one had ever attempted, you know, at scale to unify 4 billion people with real values, real heroes, and real stories. And one thing that One Championship has been able to thread is that, you know, it's local relevance, but global appeal. Because Asians are the, you know, there's an Asian history, so the talent pool of the world's best martial artists, they live in Asia. If you say, who's the best striker in the world? It's a Muay Thai world champion, bar none, all over the world. There's no question, if, ands, or buts. And if you're an expert martial artist like Joe Rogan, he'll tell you that. And that's why in the martial arts community, the several hundred million practitioners and fans of martial arts, real martial arts around the world, you know, obviously view One Championship as the home of martial arts because of its authenticity. And that's something that I'm very proud of. But at the same time, you know, I had no idea that it would skyrocket the way it has. Genuinely, okay? For the first 3 years, rejected by everybody. And then in the fourth year, and I remember this, you know, at the end of the third year, I call my mom, and she's this conservative Japanese lady. She didn't want me to do this in the first place. And I was on Wall Street. I had my own fund. I was doing very well. And she was very against this. And I said, Mom, man, this is so much harder than I thought, and I'm thinking about quitting. And then my mom said, you see, I told you so. And then she said, why don't you just quit? And, you know, just like moms do, they know what to say, right? All moms know what to say to get you to do something. And so I hung up the phone, and those words of, why don't you just quit, really stuck in my head. And then I said, there's no way I'm going to quit the greatest passion in my life. There's no way I'm going to quit the mission of unleashing real-life superheroes who ignite the world with hope, strength, dreams, and inspiration. There's no way that I'm not going to produce Asia's first true global sports media property at scale, 4 billion people. And here's a crazy stat for you, right? In America, the number one sports property, NFL, market value of approximately $92 billion. Super Bowl Sunday, you'll get 1 in 3 Americans watching. So East Coast, West Coast, there's a 3-hour time zone difference. 1 in 3 Americans, so 100 million Americans watching Super Bowl. In Asia, if you take that exact same 3-hour time zone, there's 3 billion viewers. So the fact that we hit 29 million as an average, and last year our high was 87 million viewers for a single event, you know, almost matching a Super Bowl. But there's 3 billion potential concurrent viewers. So for me, we're just at the very first ending of the story. So people say, oh man, it's amazing, you're a $1 billion property, how did you do it? I look at the numbers and I'm like, man, there is no reason why we shouldn't be able to overtake NFL, NBA, EPL. There's no reason why, because the numbers in Asia are just so massive, and one championship metrics literally every week, it's like exploding every week. It's like, I thought in COVID we would get hit. I thought for sure we're gonna get hit because we don't have live events, but we still broke records, record high. So it's a lot of it's luck, I have to admit. A lot of it's right time, right place. And a lot of it is just sheer naivete and stupidity by me to think that I could do this. And then, of course, again, I'll go back to the greatest. I serve the greatest team in the world, and they create all this incredible content that fans love. And that's why our metrics keep on skyrocketing.
You know, Chatri, I'm sure that a lot of people who are with us on SportsPro Asia, and this, by the way, is such a popular talk, this one, are going to be asking questions. We'll have a Q&A session a little bit later on. But I'm interested now, you know, scale, potential, engagement. At what point do you start turning to revenue? You spoke about, you know, a tipping point at certain stages. You know, you're looking, you know, barter versus cash. I'm very interested in terms of, you know, getting to carriage, like in the States, a little bit later on. But as far as, you know, the broader business is concerned right now, how do you turn potential and engagements, and this is, of course, something that interests everybody who is in this space right now, into real return on investment?
Yeah. I mean, like I said, it's all the strategy you take. And we were very fortunate to have Sequoia Capital, our largest institutional investor. You know, they were investors in Google, WhatsApp, YouTube, all the iconic tech companies, Airbnb, all the companies that had to invest heavily for several years in reach, frequency, engagement in the consumer before they monetized. And we were on that monetization journey already. 2019 was a record high revenue for us. And, you know, I expect that next year is going to be record high. I'll give you an example, like, you know, The Apprentice show that we're launching is already a profitable business for us. Esports is already done profitable events. Martial arts lags a little bit, but I believe over time it's going to be immensely profitable. Again, it's just the right time, right place, and when you turn the monetization engine on. You see, at the end of the day, what do brands care about? What do broadcasters care about? What do governments care about? Viewership numbers and engagement. The fact that our Facebook and our Instagram and all that stuff, you know, has massive engagement and growing rapidly. The fact that, you know, we're now either number one or number two in every country that we are in our core markets in Asia, and oftentimes head and shoulders above the incumbent sports properties. And, you know, all that eventually, I mean, broadcasters will want to pay for that. And so we're taking our time. We're very lucky, again, that we have investors who really believe in the company and really believe. So it's, you know, Sequoia Capital, who has done the whole tech thing and understands burning cash and investing in the ecosystem, investing in the brand, investing in the product, investing in capabilities of the company. That's far more important, as long as the health metrics keep going. And I'll tell you, the health metrics for me, viewership numbers, engagement numbers, you know, our digital social metrics, all that, every week I get. And health metrics for me is like, if you're a human being, you know, what is your resting heart rate? What are your cholesterol levels? You know, full body check. And so our health metrics are very strong and improving every week. And so again, it's just an inevitability for me. I'm playing the long game. Like, I was never in this thing for a quick buck. I was never in this thing for, you know, to sell. This is my life's work. This is my greatest passion. And you will see me here for the next 50 years. Much in the same way Bernie Ecclestone built F1 or Vince McMahon built WWE. There's no difference. They are passionate about what they're doing and spent their entire life. And the same with me. This is my life calling. This is going to be my legacy for my children, my grandchildren, my great-grandchildren. You know, and if you look at the sports properties, right, NBA or NFL, NFL took 100 years to make. NBA took 30 years before it was able to even have reasonable financials. 30 years. So the fact that we're doing it in 9 years, you know, I predict, again, like internally, our prediction is within 12 months, we're going to break even as a company and be profitable. So the long journey, well, long in my time, but when I look at the journey of NFL or NBA or EPL, these things take decades and decades to entrench into society, into culture, into the way of life before they can become massive scale businesses. But again, NFL, $92 billion property. NBA, $54 billion property. MLB, $52 billion property. F1, tens of billions. EPL, tens of billions. Champion League, tens of billions. And mark my words, one champion will surpass all of them. When all is said and done,
okay,
one champion will surpass all of them. And I don't say that from an arrogant perspective. Chuck, all of you are screwed up, very, very lucky. But when you look at the metrics, right, no other sports property in the world is growing as fast as we are, full stop.
Yeah, I get it. Look, in the here and the now, you mentioned the martial arts could do a little bit better. When I look at UFC, all I see is sponsors, advertisers, just every step of the way, every single part of the broadcast when I'm watching it on Fox Sports or here in Asia or ESPN in the States. What is it going to take? Is it going to come down to really monetizing the broadcast revenues? What's it going to take for martial arts to become as profitable as it could be? Because obviously you have putting events on, the kind of, you know, purses that you're paying, you've got massive costs attached to it.
Yeah, definitely. You know, outstanding question. You know, the UFC started in 1993, 27 years ago. We started 9 years ago. So the fact that I've already surpassed their viewership numbers, on a per event basis says a lot. But at the same time, we're a young property. Again, like, I'll go back to NBA or NFL or any of these iconic sports properties. But mark my words, what's going to happen next 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, my incredible team and I are going to be driving even harder than ever. And again, just to give you organic video metrics. Okay, oh, these are organic video metrics. 5 years ago, we were at roughly 150,000 views for the whole year. This year, organic, not paid, organic is going to cross 6 billion, just to give you perspective. And we see those numbers, actually 6 billion is just going to be a drop in the bucket. And I don't know, a lot of these social media consultancies like Social Bakers or the one in LA is escaping me, Tubular Labs, they put us at, you know, number 5, number 10 in the world in terms of social and digital metrics. Bigger than all of our competitors. And if I saw mathematically that it was impossible to grow, then I would be like, yeah. But like I said, Asia has 4 billion people. Last year, we hit a high of 87 million viewers in a single event. But that's nothing, because why can't we have like Super Bowl Sunday? Why can't we have a billion concurrent viewers out of 3 billion? Because ultimately, what is One Champion's formula? We're not espousing violence and hatred and anger and controversy and all the other stuff. We're espousing wholesome values that every family wants to celebrate with their kids. We are unleashing real-life superheroes who are great role models for society, for culture. And we're telling these incredible stories that inspire humanity. And for me, that formula is infinitely scalable. And that's why, precisely why, entire countries will get rally behind their hero with one championship. It's not about, you know, selling a fight. When you sell a fight, you have all this trash talking and da-da-da-da. But what does it do? What does it really do to society? What are you really teaching that 10-year-old kid? I'll never let my children put up posters of the vast majority of the superstars of other organizations. I will never let them put posters in the bedroom. But, you know, I can tell you, every mom has no shame of putting Angela Lee in their bedroom, you know, one of our heroes, because of her incredible, the incredible human being she is, character and values and achievements against all odds, and being strong, intelligent, kind, humble, a sweet woman, superwoman. And so that's what One Champion is really about. It's about celebrating the very best of humanity. It's about inspiring the world to dream more, do more, be more in life. And that's literally the mission since day one. Nothing has changed. Again, what I just never, genuinely, I never expected to ever be here at this scale so quickly. I thought this was going to be, I don't know, 30 years, just like NBA or NFL took. And I was prepared to spend the next 30 years of my life to do it. But, you know, I never would have dreamed that by year seven, we were a billion-dollar property and investors gave us about $352 million invested in the company. And it's still just a drop in the bucket and just the very, very beginning of the One Champion story. I'm telling you guys, we are only the first inning because of how big the market is and how small we are still relative to the market. Again, if we were at 500 million viewers per event or a billion viewers per event, I'd say, man, like, okay, now we're kind of like, what do we do next? But when I look at esports and gaming in Asia, 1.3 billion gamers, when I look at martial arts, Asia's greatest cultural treasure, these are the two content stacks that dominate, you know, the mobile device. No other form of content in Asia dominates the mobile device. It's gaming or it's martial arts, nothing else. These are, you know, these millennials have such a short attention span. You know, you're never gonna see golf on the mobile device. The ball's too small, can't see it. Basketball, same thing, too long form, like I can't see it. Baseball, can't see it. And it's not relevant in Asia anyways. It's really hard. And you're not gonna watch a 200 lap race for F1 on your mobile device. But you will see a match that's a couple minutes long on your mobile device. You will watch gaming or gamers. And so that's the strategy of One Champions. It's literally to be the sport for millennials, the sports property for millennials. And that's why we have the two content stats, which is martial arts and gaming.
Okay, I just want to get into the gaming thing. I mean, the gaming space, you know, it looks to me to be very heavily populated, fragmented in some ways, and a very interesting one in terms of, you know, engagement itself doesn't necessarily lead to any revenue unless you happen to be staging, you know, an absolutely massive tournament, and that in itself has taken years to build. I remember talking to somebody from Riot Games some time back about League of Legends, and they were telling me that, you know, they didn't have a problem at all with some kid jumping on YouTube and letting everybody see him play, and, you know, that didn't matter because it was the merchandising, it was all the spin-offs, it was all the collateral stuff that was going to work. So now that you've dipped your toe in that particular market, what do you make of how that's evolving?
Like I said, the esports business has already hit profitability in certain events, and especially in these online tournaments that we're doing are all profitable. And so that has been quite surprising. But there's so many ways to monetize, right? As long as our brand grows, as long as our reach, frequency, engagement numbers grow, as long as, you know, all the most important health metrics grow, it's an inevitability that you know, broadcasters will pay billions of dollars for One Championship content. It's an inevitability that brands will want to pay billions of dollars to be associated with One Championship. And that's why we have, you know, in the combat sports space, we have the most number of Fortune 500 brands by far of any organization. Literally these conservative brands that never touch combat sports are sponsors of One Championship. And, you know, whether it's Shiseido, whether it's, you know, Casio, Sony, whether it's, you know, Unilever, you know, these really mainstream conservative brands, Disney, the list goes on and on, because people understand we're celebrating Asia's greatest cultural treasure. we are the sport of the future for martial arts and gaming, targeting millennials. And so again, that is the most important thing, right? It's like, for me, revenues and financials is a byproduct of all those things. If you don't have viewership numbers that are growing every day, if you don't have social and digital view numbers growing every day, if you don't have values, heroes, and stories that genuinely all of humanity can celebrate, those are the underlying metrics that matter most. It doesn't matter. And then eventually, of course, you know, and we're seeing it. Like I said, our revenues hit record high in 2019, and we're looking very strong with profitable content stacks in different business units of ours. We are in multiple discussions with broadcasters around the world. So let's see what happens in the interim. But like I said, I predict that one championship will be break even and profitable within 12 months.
That's a great call. It's a great time for us to start thinking about Q&A, I think, Chatri, right now, because we've got just over 10 minutes to go. We've had a couple of questions come in already from Dave. Dave, I don't think I'm going to try and pronounce your surname and mangle it. That just wouldn't be right. But, you know, I think you're going to touch it. And please, everybody, get your questions in. We've got 10 minutes, as I was saying. Chatri's, as you can tell, going to be willing to handle anything that's thrown at him. Just going to start off with this one here. This was Dave going right back to when you spoke about your failures. He asked, what was your first significant yes or success after those initial rejections? What was the big yes?
Well, the big yes that I remember most is when Heliconia Capital Management, Derek Lau, the CEO of a $1 billion fund that's wholly owned by Temasek Holdings, decided to invest in One Championship. That was a moment that I really remember because, you know, my naivete, my stupidity, whatever you want to call it, for the first few years of the company, I mean, I was burning through millions of my own money, my best friend's money. Nothing was happening. There's no health metrics. Literally nothing was happening. It was just a disaster. And we didn't have distribution, you know, convincing people. It was just like one nightmare after nightmare. And I remember very well, like, I think the company had a few months of cash left. And I get this email from Heliconia Capital Management, and they say, "Chatri, do you want to? Can we meet for coffee?" And I said, "No." You know, I was not in a good place, and again, nothing was happening. And things were starting to happen, but I didn't realize that we were about to skyrocket from 150,000 video views to, you know, 6 billion. I had no idea about that trajectory. I just could see a little bit of activity, but after many years of no activity, you know, it could just have been a blip, right? But I met with them, and I think several weeks later they invested. And then several months after that, Sequoia Capital had heard about One Championship and asked for an urgent breakfast meeting on a Sunday. So crazy story with Sequoia Capital. You know, obviously, arguably the world's greatest venture capital firm, right? Investing in all the iconic Apple, Cisco, Google, WhatsApp, Airbnb, you know, all the most iconic startups that became global giants. I had went to go visit our bankers, and I had this one page of our metrics, our TV ratings, our social media organic video views, and all the metrics that we have. And it was on a one piece of paper, and I was discussing with my bank, "Hey, I'm thinking about, I would like to go on a roadshow in 6 months, and what do you think about these metrics?" And he just, when I left his office, he took that piece of paper, happened to be carrying it, went into an elevator. True story, went into an elevator. And the managing director of Sequoia Capital Asia looks at that piece of paper, happens to be in the elevator, and said, "Hey, what company is that?" And he goes, "Oh, it's a company called One Championship. It's a sports property." And literally, Shailendra Singh said, "Let me look at those metrics." He looked at the metrics and he told our banker, "I can have a term sheet ready for you in 24 hours. I want to meet the founder." And that was a Friday, and Sunday morning, I was having breakfast with Shailendra, and several weeks after that, they invested. And now they're our largest institutional shareholder. And we're their first sports investment in history. And I often joke around with people, but it's the truth. I feel like I'm Forrest Gump. Like, I just kind of stumbled along. I was naive, innocent. I had no media experience, you know, thinking I could create Asia's first global sports media property, and got a lot of lucky blessings. I'm telling you, man, I work my ass off, but so many lucky blessings in people who believed in me, whether it's governments or broadcasters who give me that first break. Believe it or not, it took Media Corp in Singapore, it took us 8 years until we came on air. 8 years of begging, clawing, negotiating, and hoping before they aired us. And now they're massive supporters of One Championship. There's so many lucky breaks. Just kindness, random kindness that I never expected. People taking a chance on us when we were nothing and nobody. And I'm eternally grateful.
Yeah, listen, you go above and beyond with every answer. I'm gonna do a little 5 minute thing now with you now, Chatri. Let's just do some quick fire stuff, okay? I know some of these questions I'm gonna fire at you won't be given to particularly quick fire stuff, but I just wanna try and be representative of a couple here. This one came in from Dave again, just talking about how fragmented is your strategy across different Asian markets, or are you relatively consistent? Can you give us a quick answer on that?
The underlying formula is very consistent. Values, heroes, and stories, right? As I said, and our mission. But each market, you have to localize very, very deeply. Local language, local heroes. You got to have a cultural content that's very, very different. So sense of humor in Japan is very different than China, very different than Thailand, very different than Indonesia. Etiquette, manners, all these things are make a huge difference in terms of your engagement levels in each country.
Okay, I'm gonna dive into another one here. I've just lost your audio there, Chatri. Yeah.
Can you hear me?
I just lost your sound there, guys. Yeah, I've got you back now. Carry on.
Okay. Oh, so I was just saying that we localize very deeply, right? You have to localize. The sense of humor is very different in China versus Japan versus Thailand versus Indonesia, But the underlying formula of values, heroes, and stories, the underlying mission doesn't change. We're really genuinely trying to espouse the best of humanity and unite humanity through Asia's greatest cultural treasure. But what changes is you have to go very deep, very local language, local cultural. There's etiquette, there's cultural norms, there's religion. There's a lot of different things that you have to really wrap around in order to get deep engagement at the local level.
This strikes me as being a really good way to sort of maybe wrap things up here. Mark McFarland asking, what are your metrics of growth and success?
So the most important thing is reach, frequency, engagement. I always say that to our company. Reach, how many people are we reaching every day, every event, every week? Frequency, how often are they engaging with our content? Again, whether this is free to air, whether it is digital, social, it doesn't matter what platform, what country. And then engagement, how long are they engaging for and how deeply committed are they? So obviously, the shades of gray, there's different countries that are very, very strong. There's countries that are mediocre. There's countries that are becoming strong, et cetera. But reach, frequency, engagement. Of course, there's obviously sub-metrics underneath that. But for me, as a media property, the most important thing is reach, frequency, engagement. And as long as your numbers are hockey sticking the way our numbers are, reach every day, every week, every month, you're going to be in a great place. And so, this is the challenge of incumbent sports properties. A lot of incumbent sports properties, their metrics are flat. Even if you look at soccer in Asia, it's flat. It's not like it's a growing sport. So there are challenges. Of course, soccer is still the number one sport in Asia, but the metrics are flat. And so, and I would say some incumbent global sports, right, the metrics are trending downwards, right? The average viewer is a 40 or 50-year-old male. Millennial audience is not attracted to it. So those are really dangerous because you might have great financials, but if your underlying health metrics are deteriorating, eventually it'll catch up with you. So I'd much rather be a company that has accelerating metrics and we're still not valued at 50 billion or 100 billion yet. We don't have those financials, but our metrics are very, very strong and improving literally every week, every day. I mean, so.
Okay, just quickly, because you mentioned a couple of sports there, this might be a very quick answer. Christian Daly wrote in saying, do you foresee one expanding beyond esports and martial arts, or will you stick with your core sports?
So when we entered esports, people were kind of perplexed, but we did a strategic review, very, very careful strategic review about esports market. And what we found again, because Asia, you know, the millennials, the number one sport is gaming in Asia, right? 1.3 billion gamers. Yep. And martial arts. And so we said, look, we did an in-depth study strategically. The platform we built, how can we leverage that for esports? Is there overlap? And so some countries, literally 45% of our fan base were gamers. And we're like, okay, what are the most popular games in the region? And we built a business plan around it and hired a top gun CEO from the US. And like I said, its financials are much better than our first year financials in martial arts, you know, way back 9 years ago. And that was that was surprising. But again, the whole strategy is to own the mobile device, right? If you think about millennials, you know, in our generation, or most people here on the conference, our generation, we watch TV, our parents watch TV. That's our first window, media window. Today, the millennial, it's the mobile device. And so if you don't know how to catch them with a mobile device, forget about all the other platforms. Forget about smart TV. Forget about free-to-air TV. Forget about digital. You'll get killed. The first is you've got to dominate the mobile device. And that's our strategy. Dominate the mobile device. And from there, all good things will happen.
Chatri, we're done. We're just about done for time. I'm going to have to say thank you. We're going to wrap it up now. Take care. And thanks so much for sharing today.
Thank you so much, everybody. Appreciate your time.
All right. Chatri.